I really like that some of what I'm going to say in talking about the work that we do at Awakn Clinics, delivering ketamine-assisted psychotherapy, is following on from Youth's presentation with the recommendations that he's making and some of the conclusions he's drawn, because it's nice to be able to say that these are things that we're doing. But I also want to confess to just kind of being slightly amused about being stood here in front of you just to tell you what I do 3 days a week at work, because I'm not presenting a particular study or piece of research, but really just describing to you what we do at the clinic and what I do. And that should be interesting to you is interesting to me. And I've been wondering, like, what are we all missing by being here? And what's going on in the other rooms? Because if you've been in a queue with me and you've asked me, what do you do for a living, you would have heard this talk already, just without the slides. And if you've been in a queue with me waiting for coffee or lunch, you might have heard this talk with the slides. So if you have a desire to catch something else, you can always hear this talk from me just by approaching me and asking me, what is it that you do 3 days a week at work? Over in Hoffman Hall, David Aritsu is talking about, he's given an update on psychedelic treatment for depression. And although I've heard him talk before and give some fascinating data, I'm really curious to know what update he's giving over there now. And I'm wondering if the update is that it's kind of depressing that psilocybin still hasn't been rescheduled or decriminalized for use in therapy, and that's also depressing. And so we even all the more need those changes in the law to access those medicines for clinical treatment outside of trials. And I know that across the hall, Geronimo Mazares is giving a talk on should modern psychedelic medicine take lessons from ceremonial traditions. Don't you want to know the answer to that question? Like, I think the answer is probably yes, and then a lot of information about how or why. I'm glad that all of these sessions will be available on YouTube so that we can catch up on what we missed out. But I'm also really curious about a talk that's happening across the way by Andy Letcher. I love the title, Lost for Words. Are psychedelic experiences actually ineffable? And then I imagine that the answer to that question is yes. And then there's 30 minutes of just silently pondering that. Or maybe the answer to that question is no, not really, not if we make up a whole bunch of new words and then we can describe really accurately what's happening when we're having a psychedelic experience. So, but I'm happy to see that there's a bunch of people who are not in this room because at 10 o'clock they chose to go and do a psychedelic expansive breath experience. And that's probably what I would choose, because although I'm both a clinical psychologist and a psychotherapist working for very many years in the field of psychological therapies, I'm also a breath worker, and just over the last few years have discovered how powerful and psychedelic-like that work can be. Absolutely free and with no laws against it. So if you get the opportunity to breathe, please do. So I'm going to give you an introduction to ketamine-assisted psychotherapy at the model that we're using at the Awakn Clinics. I work at the London Clinic. We also have a clinic in Bristol. We have a clinic over in Oslo and a clinic under development in Trondheim. I'll give you a brief overview of the model that we use, talk a little bit about case studies, and share some reflections just from my direct experience. Like, the clinic that I work in has got 7 therapists. I'm one of them. There are 2 nurses there, a consultant psychiatrist, and the clinic director. And we're all involved from the first point of contact with people who are self-referring or referred to us by clinicians. We're all involved in the taking that person through in a caring way through the pathway, whether they come in to see us for treatment, go through a full course of treatment or not. And I think that's a really important part of the work, that the team is a group of people who are experienced clinicians, but really compassionate, really caring, and with different degrees of experience in working with psychedelics. And I think that's part of what makes that team, that clinic, the work special.
So,
just bear with me because I can't read the slide at the back. So we're using ketamine in the clinic, as already covered by Celia and a bit use talk. That's safe drug to use, used all over the world, daily in anesthesia and A&E clinics and with children, and very low risk of respiratory or cardiac problems. And also useful in the therapeutic setting because we can do these sessions within a couple of hours, unlike the 6-8 hours or longer that are needed for working with more classical psychedelics. So what are we doing? So really, we're taking the neuroplasticity that's afforded by ketamine, and we're using a therapeutic approach that increases psychological flexibility. And we're doing that with the idea that, you know, adding the ketamine is kind of shaking things up. Sometimes this metaphor, this analogy is used of creating a fresh layer of snow on top of tracks with well-worn or long-standing, rigid ways of thinking, feeling, or being and behaving in the world. And we're throwing a fresh layer of snow over that in order to create some new pathways or new directions, new opportunities for change or different perspectives.
Sorry.
And our emphasis in the clinic is really on the ketamine as an aid to the therapy. So it's embedded within the therapy, but our focus is on the client being actively involved. So not just coming in and being a passive recipient of ketamine and then hoping that that will cure and solve everything, but using the ketamine as an aid to the therapy, being actively involved in making the kind of changes that we need to make in order for things to be different. In my own observation, people coming into the clinic with the expectation that ketamine is going to do all the work, and they don't need to do anything or don't want to do anything, experience a bit more disappointment. Maybe they experience a little mood lifting from the ketamine, but overall disappointment if they're expecting that the ketamine will be the cure, which we've heard is not, and we want to avoid thinking about it in that way. I remember a long time ago in learning this little phrase in psychology, if you always do what you've always done, you always get what you always got. You always feel what you've always felt. You always think what you've always thought. And the key thing there is it starts with doing, like what you're actually doing, your actions, your behavior. And that's part of the focus of our treatment. It's not just receiving the ketamine, having that experience, but what you do with that experience. Whether that experience is light or just a distortion of perceptions or really strong, like transpersonal cosmic experience, whatever happens, we want to make something, we want to find the meaning in that and then use that to bring to the kind of change we want to see in our lives. So we can learn something from whatever happens in the dosing sessions. But I'll describe more about that process. So these are the conditions or the symptoms that we treat. You have to have had a diagnosis of depression or anxiety disorders, various anxiety disorders, social anxiety, general anxiety, OCD. PTSD, substance use problems, eating disorders, and we use Celia's model care for treating alcohol use disorders. So you have to have had a diagnosis of these things. You have to also have had and tried treatment for these things when you come to the clinic. And like that's it's interesting how we use these sort of diagnostic categories. But I really find myself thinking much more about like what's going on, what is actually underlying these symptoms, where do these things come from, how did they form, and their roots being in childhood experiences and childhood development, particularly with parents and caregivers, and whether needs were adequately met, or how a child would have learned to survive or endure the conditions in which they were being cared for when their needs maybe were not adequately met. And the patterns and tendencies that they form, which continue into adult life, but then become problematic because they're not serving as effectively when the conditions of being an adult are different from those being a child. And I'll say a bit more about particular observations, I think, that I've seen with people coming for treatment who are just really nice, actually. Just really nice. Very, very appeasing, very agreeable, very placating. And from one perspective, we can see that as having formed a protective response, a defensive response to cope with stress in childhood, which is just the fawning response, always doing what others ask or want, always putting other people's needs first, never being able to really acknowledge and express one's own needs, and how much suffering comes with that, even though on the outside it can be experienced as just being really, really nice. But having to lose oneself. So I see some of that sometimes as having kind of mastered a fawning response or a protective response that it's really not easy to change. This slide is just giving information about the screening, how people come into the clinic. So they have to have tried at least two other treatments for whatever condition you've been diagnosed with, medicinal or non-medicinal. It's an adult service, so we're treating people who are age 18 and over. When we screen, we look at physical health risks, so that people shouldn't have any sort of cardiac or respiratory problems or liver functioning problems. And we look at mental health history to screen out people with a history of psychosis, or with current severe suicide risk, or with manic episodes and by a diagnosis of bipolar disorder. And that is all done by the consultant psychiatrist during an initial medical assessment. And occasionally we have a therapist sit in on that assessment too, and the nurse is involved in looking at the physical health checks. And we do all that as part of the initial visit into the clinic. And this slide is just showing how we try to formulate the information that we gather when someone comes to us and we want to understand what's the problem, what is the problem that they're wanting to change or wanting to solve. And this formulation is quite commonly used in psychology, or sometimes referred to as the 5P model. So we're looking at what is the problem? The problem is usually some form of unwanted thought or unwanted feeling or physical experience or unwanted behavior that's proving difficult to change. We consider the vulnerability factors or predisposing factors. How did you get here? How did this happen? What is the history? What are the childhood development experiences, including any problems in attachment or what conditioned survival strategies have formed? And what's happening now? What are the precipitating or the triggering events? Why now? Why are you seeking treatment again now? Or what's happening now, or what's happened in the past that has meant that the problem hasn't been solved? What therapies, what benefits have been experienced from therapy? What's still missing? And the perpetuating factors. So what's keeping things going? What are the maintaining things, thoughts, behavior patterns, and any protective factors? So really understanding what resources are available, what sources of support, what are the person's reasons for living or skills and abilities they have, and supportive relationships. And I kind of make sense of this in a slightly different way sometimes, thinking about some teachings from Gabor Mate, who's a psychiatrist, and I think he's Hungarian psychiatrist in Canada. And I like this way of understanding what's going on with somebody, like what's the problem. So we all need a set of skills, right? We all need a set of skills. We need to be able to feel our feelings. And that means to like experience what are feelings. Feelings are sensations in the body. Emotions are sensations in the body. We need the skill of being able to feel our feelings, to be aware of what's happening in our bodies, and to be able to tolerate that and accept it without fearing it, without fearing sensations, even when they're very intense. So that's an important skill. And one of the ways that we acquire that skill in childhood is when we have others, parents, carers, who could soothe and comfort us when we experience intense sensations, and they can co-regulate with us and help us to be accepting and okay with feelings and not afraid of them. So we need that skill. So when I'm getting to know somebody, either using the 5P formulation model or just getting to know them in assessment, I'm thinking about how well does this person seem able just to feel their feelings? And then we need another skill, the skill of being able to express those feelings effectively. What does that mean? To be able to express the feelings effectively is to be able to communicate those or to act on the urge that comes with those feelings in the environment if the feeling is actually driving us to do something for our safety or for protection. Not expressing feelings or repressing them, rather, bottling them up or acting them out are not effective ways of handling feelings. So we need to learn those skills, also skills that we learn in childhood from parents or caregivers who have compassionate understanding for what we're going through and take the time to teach us or help us communicate with words what we're feeling and understand when a feeling is giving a signal, an important message to take some action. And then we need the skill also of distinguishing between feelings that are being triggered by something that's happening here and now in the moment, and feelings that are actually triggered from a residue or a reservoir of suppressed emotions. We need the skill of being able to tell the difference, whether we're responding to something in this moment or responding to something that's actually unresolved from the past that we've been bottling up. So you can tell, like, big overreactions to small things often can be like a sign that there's a lot more about that issue, that particular sensitivity. And then we need the skill of being able to get our needs met and balance those with meeting the needs of others so that we're not sort of over-engaged in just meeting others' needs or behaving in ways to get acceptance or approval or love, but able to acknowledge our own thoughts, feelings, and needs, express those, and accept when those don't necessarily satisfy or meet the wishes of others. So those are a whole bunch of skills that we all do very well to acquire and to practice. And an imbalance in any of those areas, or a deficiency in skills in any of those areas, can identify like a target for change. And we're using, in Awakn, in our ketamine-assisted psychotherapy, we're using an ACT protocol from acceptance and commitment therapy. So if you caught Henry Whitfield's talk on Thursday, I think it is, you might have heard a really nice explanation of using ACT, formulating things using the ACT model with the spectrum of selves. And so we use this for several reasons. One is there's lots of evidence to support the use of ACT therapy for the conditions that we treat. So that exists already. And it's a kind of therapy that, thank you, it's a kind of therapy that you can learn. It's sort of learning some of the skills I was just describing, but you can learn them with the right sort of focus and quite the teaching of it is kind of can be quite quick. So it fits our model because our model is quite short. So when we're the skills of actor, to be present, to be open, and to do what matters. And what's the, when you're not doing that, what are you doing? So if you're not present, where are you? Or what are you doing? You're on automatic pilot. Your body is here, but your mind is elsewhere. And you're not even really connected to what's right in front of you. And if you're responding to what's right in front of you, it helps to be present to it. It helps to see what's happening, to be there with your full body and your full senses versus automatic pilot. And we can go through automatic pilot really effectively in our lives day to day. It can really help us do quite a lot of things. But to be there all the time is to be slightly detached as well from our lives in the moment. ACT teaches us to be open and accepting to what's happening, including the thoughts and feelings which are always arising and passing through, rather than closed off and constantly trying to control them or not feel them or get rid of them or eliminate them, both what's going on inside of us and external to us. ACT teaches us to clarify our values, figure out what's important to us, what matters to us, how we want to be in ourselves and in life, and then to move our body in the direction to live by those values rather than to be unclear, unfocused, or just not knowing what we want, what's important, who we want to be, or how. ACT teaches us to have a mindful practice which strengthens the observer perspective or the self as context. So the ability to see your thoughts and your feelings passing through, but not to get so attached to them or not to see them as being you or believing that is all there is to you, the story and the thoughts, which can very often be very critical, self-critical, and painful, and then cause behavior that's narrowing life. So we're using the ACT model for this psychological flexibility. We're using that model in preparation and integration sessions in order to make best use of the period of neuroplasticity given by the ketamine. And it requires action. So it requires identifying therapy goals, identifying values, identifying therapy goals, and then small steps towards those goals. So, okay. We I'll show you this slide. Okay, it's the next slide. Okay, so let me show you this first. So this is the sequence of sessions. It's 11 sessions, beginning with two preparation sessions, which are an hour long each. And then followed by that, we have 4 weeks where we have dosing on one day and integration on the next day. 4 weeks, and then 3 weeks after that, we have a final evaluation. So the preparation sessions can be done at the same time, like 2 hours in one day. The first hour consists largely of identifying values, orientating the client to the therapy model, or using both the ketamine and the ACT model. The preparation session includes understanding what's happening in the dosing, the setup, lying down, how to ask for support, trying on the earphones through which the music is played, trying on the mindfolds, having the weighted blanket pulled over you, just feeling what it's like to lie there, how you'll be supported if you reach out and you want support with your hand, and just experiencing that before the dosing day. And so there's time in the preparation to get ready to understand how the model works and what to expect with the ketamine. You're getting to know your therapist. A really important part of that is building rapport, building the therapeutic relationship, helping the person to feel safe, secure, and to know that the therapist will be there with them all the time throughout the session, and they'll be well looked after. And we discuss also dosing. We typically start with 0.5 milligrams per kilogram. It's delivered intramuscularly by one of the nurses who will come into the room briefly to do that. And then the person gets settled, and we talk in each integration session about what the experience was like with the dosing, whether they want to increase that in the following dose, the next dosing session, and what meaning they made of whatever experience they had. Yeah, so those are the three phases: preparation, ketamine-assisted sessions, and integration, and the final evaluation afterwards. So I think I've said a little bit about this. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've described everybody what happens in the preparation session. And then in the ketamine-assisted sessions, so these are the dosing sessions. We really encourage the experience to be internal, going inward with the mask, and the music is playing in the room, but also through the earphones. And that's largely self-directed as to whether or not somebody wants support, but we're nearby. And I can share a little bit from my experience about dosing someone who just talked continuously through their whole dosing for 45 minutes. And I would have loved to have captured some of what they were saying, but they were holding my right hand for the whole time as well. So it wasn't, and I am right-handed, so it wasn't really possible to write it all down. And, you know, we talked a bit about whether it might've been meaningful to have recorded all of what they were saying. We hadn't done that. And thinking about a few particular clients that I've worked with, starting on 0.5 milligrams per kilogram and then coming out of that and saying there's just no way I would need a higher dose. That was strong enough. And then the same person being increasingly willing to experience what would happen by increasing the dose, and ending up feeling that they had seen things never seen before, had breakthroughs, or gotten to the bottom of something when they tried slightly higher doses. And conversely, I've also worked with people who have just not felt very much of anything on each of the increased doses. And like I mentioned at the beginning, with the expectation that the ketamine would somehow cure the problem, finding that experience very disappointing. So the variety, it's really a wide range in what people experience and feel for the different doses. And I'm not sure how much of that is affected just by their expectations. But that's one of the really interesting lessons about what happens to people in this therapy. Integration sessions, that's where we're talking about making meaning of what happened, and then the opportunity to be a bit more directive, to link to all of the skills that we're learning, that we're talking about from the ACT model, what will be done in between sessions, because the integration goes beyond just that hour spent on the day after the dosing, and requires action. It's a bit about developments that we're working on to further support integration. Over in our Bristol clinic, they've been offering integration groups, which are focused mainly on mindfulness and self-compassion practice. We also offer individual therapy sessions because people have asked for those after having a course of CAP, but wanting to stay continuing working with the therapist. Thank you. And being offered sort of short course of therapy, because some of the people that we see are already in therapy or already have a therapist, and we're certainly willing to, and we have liaised with their existing therapist to allow their course of CAP to just be like an add-on to their normal course of therapy. And that's proven very helpful in working with people who wanted to come in but continue their long-standing relationship with their existing therapist. I think I've run out of time before I've gotten to the case studies.